Okay. Good evening to everyone. Today we will discuss disease management in coconut with emphasis on Ganoderma. Myself, Dr. A. Snehalatha, scientist plant pathology working at HRS Kovur. Through all the 12 lectures of this coconut graduate readiness program, by now you all know that coconut, the Kalpavruksha, is one of the important plantation crops in India, particularly southern states of the India. And it is being cultivated in an area of 2.1 million hectares with a production of approximately 14,000 million nuts. And it is contributing to national GDP of 10,000 crore rupees. And still there are chances of increasing the GDP from coconut with the introduction of high density planting systems such as cocoa and banana as intercrops. And farmers, even though they select the best variety and they follow the good agricultural practices, still there are some losses in coconut yield, and diseases are one of the important factors in palm loss and reduced yield loss in coconut, along with major pests. Even though we know that coconut is very hardy in nature and it is being cultivated in varied climatic conditions such as sandy soils to black soils, even though it is adaptable to varied climatic conditions, weather conditions, still it is affected by many diseases. And these diseases play an important role in reduction of yield losses in coconut. Now we'll see what are the important coconut diseases at national scenario. The major important coconut diseases are majorly these are fungal diseases, except phytoplasma, that is root wilt. This root wilt caused by phytoplasma is a major disease at national scenario, particularly in Kerala, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu states. And other important diseases are basal stem rot or Ganoderma wilt caused by Ganoderma aplanatum and Ganoderma lucidum. Two species are involved in causing this disease. Another important disease is caused by Phytophthora palmivora, stem bleeding caused by Tilaviaxis paradoxa. This basal stem rot or Ganoderma wilt, bud rot, and stem bleeding is at the three major important diseases of our state. These are the important diseases particular to Andhra Pradesh. And the minor diseases are leaf spot caused by Pestilentiasis palmarum. It is called as gray leaf spot. And the newly identified leaf spot, Lassia diplodia theobromae. This is also another important leaf spot in other states such as Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu. Until last year, it was not reported from AP, but recently our scientist Neeraja from HRS Ambajipeta, she reported the appearance of this Lassia diplodia theobromae in our state also. And these are the minor diseases in coconut. And once in the 1990s and 2000, Tatipaka disease, that is caused by phytoplasma, it was observed at that time in East Godavari district, and now it is not present in our state. And coming to the important diseases of Andhra Pradesh, this is overall 5 years data of mean percent disease incidence that is observed in five major districts: East Godavari, West Godavari, Srikakulam, Vijayanagaram, and Visakhapatnam. In those 5 years, nearly 102 villages were surveyed, and from that surveyed data, we could observe that basal stem rot or Ganoderma is the major disease in coconut, accounting to 11.23 percent disease incidence, particularly in sandy soils when compared to the black cotton soils. Stem bleeding and then bud rot, these are observed in black cotton soils, and particularly in nursery stays we could observe bud rot. And traces of gray leaf spot and recently the Lassia diplodia leaf spot is also observed. And I will emphasize morely on Ganoderma wilt, basal stem rot. Coming to the disease, it is called by various names: Ganoderma wilt in case of Andhra Pradesh, and Tanjavur wilt in case of Tamil Nadu. Because it was first observed in Tanjavur district of Tamil Nadu, they called it as Tanjavur wilt. And in Karnataka, it is called by a different name, boll rot or anabaroga. And based on the symptoms, because it affects the main trunk region, roots, every part it affects, but majorly it was observed in basal stem portion, so it is called as basal stem rot. As the pathogen involved in causing the disease is Ganoderma, it is called as Ganoderma wilt. And then it is also called as crown rot because finally the crown is affected and the entire crown, entire leaves are removed and appearance of rotting will be observed. So it is called as crown rot. These are the various names that are being called for the disease. And coming to the disease, in India, it was first reported to be caused by Ganoderma lucidum and in Karnataka state during the year 1913 by Butler. And similar symptoms of this Ganoderma lucidum were also reported to be caused by Aplanatum and lucidum, both the species in case of Andhra Pradesh by Paparao and Govindrao and Sachinarayana et al. And in case of Tamil Nadu, near Thanjavur district, this named as Thanjavur wilt, it was first noticed in the year 1952 and 56 cyclones. And in Kerala also, it was reported by Wilson. And through the literature and the disease intensity varied, and the highest disease intensity up to 50% was reported in Tamil Nadu. And coming to the occurrence and spread of basal stem rot, in this paper, the survey that is conducted in Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, in Andhra Pradesh, the major districts that are observed to be presence of this basal stem rot is East Godavari, West Godavari, Srikakulam, Visakhapatnam and Vijayanagaram, near the coastal belt and sandy soils, near the river basins such as Godavari river basins. Wherever the sandy soils are there, the disease incidence was observed. And in case of Tamil Nadu, Thanjavur, Tiruvayur, and then the Nagapattinam districts, the disease is found more. And in case of Karnataka, Hassan, Chikmagalur, Tumkur, and Shivamogga districts, these are the major districts that are found to be infected by Ganoderma. And the seasonal instance of the disease, when you conduct the survey, even though the disease is present throughout the year once the plant is infected, but based on the appearance of the symptoms and death of the plant, the disease instance was found more in between March to August. Whenever the dry period is there, the symptom appearance is more in case of Ganoderma disease. And after the infection of the plant, it may take 2 to 3 years for the plant to go for the death. After the appearance of the disease, it may take 2 to 3 years. But there are exceptions. In particular cases, sudden wilting within 6 months also you can observe, as well as in occasionally some plants, even though the infection is there, they may survive. Coming to the symptomology, the disease, when infected, it shows symptoms in all the parts such as roots, stem and crown region of the palm. And sometimes the disease is confused with the stem bleeding. And later I will show the slide where in case of pest also, red palm weevil instance also, you can observe the bleeding symptom. How to differentiate between basal stem rot, stem bleeding and red palm instance, I will show you in that slide. And occasionally the disease is confused with stem bleeding disease. And disease symptoms progress slowly. The disease first infects the root system, which is underground, and we are unable to detect whether the plant is infected or not. Like that, the disease symptom progress slowly, and all the infected plants, eventually there is death. And the disease develops from the roots, and the first visual symptoms appears on stem as reddish brown exudation. These are the symptoms on roots. You can observe the disease first infects the small roots, and from there it enters into the main root adventitious root system, and then it disintegrates entire root system. And extensive rotting and discoloration of the root system is characteristic symptom of this disease. If you pull out the diseased or dead plant, the root system, you can observe extensive rotting and discoloration of the root system, loosening of the bark also, you can see on the roots. And later, after the infection of the roots, and the rotting proceeds slowly to the upward, to the bole region or basal stem region. There also, it infects the cortical tissues, it disintegrates, and then the steel system also, it turns into the brown region. And in case of roots, you can observe that alcoholic smell. If you pull out the roots, you can observe there's some alcoholic smell from the infection. And if the plant is infected with the Ganoderma disease, later the production of new roots is also decreases, and in severely infected palms, more than 70% of the root rotting was observed. Slowly, from the root system, the pathogen enters into the basal stem region, bole region, and on the stem, the infection slowly progresses up the stem. If you see a plant, you can observe the reddish oozing from the natural cracks of the plant. Reddish color ooze, it comes out, and slowly that oozing moves from the basal stem to the upward. This exudation of reddish brown viscous fluid, this is the characteristic symptom of the basal stem rot. In stem bleeding also you can observe in particular portions, but here the root system is also infected. Slowly it enters to the stem, and on the stem the movement of the oozing from the basal stem to the upward you can observe. There are some exceptions. Occasionally some infected plants, they are unable to show the symptoms on the stem. Slowly, after movement of the reddish brown, oozing of the reddish brown liquid to the upper portion, you can also observe the loosening of the bark at the basal trunk region, and then infestation of the scolyted beetle, xyloborus infestation. Because this is the dead tissue, the beetles, they enter into the portion, and you can see the exudation of the sawdust because of the infestation of xyloborus. If you see this infestation of xyloborus, you can assume that there is a basal stem rot in the plant. And in the later stages, you can also observe the production of sporophores. This is the Ganoderma. The Ganoderma brackets you can observe at the base of the infected palm, just before the death or after the death of the plant. So in case of basal stem rot disease, based on the single plant, single symptom, you cannot say. You have to observe all the plants in the orchard, and you have to see the multiple symptoms, observe, go for multiple symptoms, and then only you can recognize it as basal stem rot. And coming to the crown region, you can see after the movement of the oozing from the basal portion to the upward stem, slowly the lower whorls of the leaves, they show withering, yellowing, and wilting symptom. Slowly the lower set of the whorl, they droops down, and slowly the middle leaves, and then the top leaves, upper leaves, all the leaves, they turn into yellow, brown, and then they wilt. Finally, the center leaf also, it wills, and then the death of the plant you can see. Finally, the stem shrivels and dries up. In advanced stages, you can see very thin decapitated stem because of the removal of the undead set of the leaves, and then there is no root production, new root production in the plant. So you can see a stem such as a pencil tip. And these are the symptoms. You can see the oozing at the basal stem portion. It slowly moves upward. These are the disease severity in Borivanka, Kaviti, and Jagati villages of Srikakulam district. The soil type is sandy soil. And in sandy soil, the disease incidence is very high. And cropping system here, we observed is sole coconut intercropped with banana or cashew, whatever the case may be. The disease intensity is very high in this Borivanka, Jagati, and Kaviti villages. And this is at Sitarampuram, Narsapur, Mandal, West Godavari district. We can see in case of basal stem rot, if a plant is infected with the disease, slowly the surrounding trees also, they show the same symptom. as it is a soil borne pathogen, as it initially infects root system only, so the spread of the disease in the soil is adjacent plants. You can see adjacent plants after 3 months or 6 months, you can observe the disease on adjacent plants. So if you go for identification of the pathogen by cell stem rot, you have to see whether a particular patch is infected, and slowly whether we are observing that disease is moving from side by plants to the side by plants. And this is in black soil, the Gulluru village of Palakollu mandal, where coconut plants are observed in rice buns. And here also all the plants are decapitated, and you can see only standing of the trunk regions. Slowly it moves from one plant to one plant, one plant to one plant, and the disease also appears on palmyra, which is occasionally we see on rice field buns or any surrounding plants. And coming to the etiology, it is caused by aplanatum, Ganoderma aplanatum and Ganoderma lucidum, belongs to the family Ganodermataceae, and then order Polyporales, class Agaricomycetes, and phylum Basidiomycota. These are the scanning electron microscope photos of the Ganoderma aplanatum and Ganoderma lucidum. Thanks to the DE sir, B. Srinivasulu sir, he took the photographs of the pathogen, and later I'll show you other pictures also how Trichoderma invades Ganoderma. And in case of Ganoderma aplanatum, the spores are dumbbell shaped, and in case of Ganoderma lucidum, the spores are attached, ball like spores you can see. And coming to the cultural characteristics, this mycelium, aerial mycelium, is hyaline, thin wall, and as it is a Basidiomycetes fungi, you can see the clamp connections with 1.4 to 2 meter diameters, and chlamydospores are thick wall, terminal or intercalary, and then ellipsoid, and sometimes in chains you can observe, and this is the size. And coming to the fruiting body, these fruiting bodies are perennial, stipitate, like stalk will be there, attachment of the bracket at the base, and usually lateral to the side, the fruiting body comes to the side of the plant, and sometimes the cell with that stalk, it will be there, and the bracket is corky at the time of starting of the appearance of the bracket. Later it turns into the woody, it will be hard. And then this is the diameter, 10 to 12 into 10 to 12 into 3 to 4 centimeters. Even though this is small, there are brackets even bigger than 30 centimeters. This surface of the bracket is shiny, lacquered crust, and ox blood in color and smooth. And below surface is whitish or creamish in color, which later turns to brown. And these are the various isolates at HRS Ambachipeta. We isolated 32 Ganoderma isolates from coconut, along with one culture from oil palm. And we studied the variability of these isolates using pathogenic virulence studies, isozyme analysis, and PCR-based studies. And this is the disease index for basal stem rot, how you can calculate, because this disease produces multiple symptoms on crown, stem, and root. The disease index can be calculated by this formula, 23.6 plus 17.7 H plus 3.6 R minus 0.6 L, where H is the height up to which bleeding has spread in the stem, L is the number of functional leaves in the crown, R is the score for reduction in leaf size. Based on this calculation of the disease index, we can score it as, if the index score is below 15, you can classify it as mildly infected. 15 to 40, you can say it as moderately infected plant. Above 40, it is severely diseased. And coming to the host range, Ganoderma infects various hosts. Wide host range we can observe, and majorly it infects the plantation crops, forest trees, and fruit trees. You can observe it in areca nut, palmyra, sesbania, And even Ganoderma infection and citrus also will be there, mango, majority of the fruit trees and plantation crops, they are infected by Ganoderma, maybe another species. And more than 44 species from 34 genera of plants have been identified as potential hosts, of which coconut and oil palm, these are the major hosts. Coming to the epidemiology, the basal stem rot we can observe majorly on older plants, above 15 years plants. Occasionally, you can observe in younger plants because the soil inoculum is always, maybe at that place is higher. Initially, the plants were dead. If you plant a plant in that pit itself, you may observe the incidence of the disease in below 5 years plants or below 10 years plants. But mostly, the disease is observed in older plantation. And the disease is mostly prevalent in sandy soils when compared to the black cotton soils. And the other factors are which lead to incidence of the disease are lack of soil moisture during summer months. Most of the cases, the coconut plantations are depends on rain fed only. And if the farmer doesn't take care and doesn't give irrigation occasionally to the plants in summer months, the disease may aggravate. And the presence of old infected stumps in the garden. This is also a major factor because as it is a soil-borne pathogen, if the plant is infected and if a plant was dead because of the disease, the inoculum, the pathogen, it slowly multiplies in the coconut plant itself, the dead coconut plant. And if we don't remove that clump, there are chances of the disease inoculum level is very high and it severely affects the coconut plant surrounding that dead plant. And injury to roots and non-adaptation of recommended cultural practices, it also play a major role. Usually the farmers while doing intercultural operations, the power tiller or some any operation, if it goes near to the plant and then roots are injured, through the injury, the pathogen enters very easily and then appearance of the disease. And coming to the weather factors, there is positive correlation between maximum temperature, minimum temperature and the disease, and negative correlation between rainfall and number of rainy days and relative humidity in response to the disease. And coming to the early detection, as it infects the root system, one of the major reasons for the reverse testing nature of BSR is inability to detect the disease in early stages. And management practices are most effective only when the disease is diagnosed at the early stages. So several researchers attempted studies how to detect the disease at the earlier time. These are the few methods which are reported by the researchers. One is biochemical methods, EDTA based method, and then indicator plants, and then molecular methods using ELISA and PCR based techniques. And some researchers, they also studied the transpiration ratio of the plant and then correlated with the disease. And indicator plants such as red gram, Bengal gram, these are also studied. I'll show the next slides. And molecular methods through polyclonal antiserum based ELISA method and then gene-specific PCR techniques. These are used for early detection of Ganoderma. These are the indicator plants that are reported from MHRS Ambajipeta. One is red gram and it shows the symptom within within 3 months. You can see the splitting of the bark of the red gram plant within 3 months. If you saw red gram seeds surrounding the coconut basin, if the soil is infested with Ganoderma, you can observe infestation of Ganoderma in red gram so that you can take care of the coconut plant before this is the early symptom. And in case of Sesbania, you can observe oozing of the oozing of the liquid at the base, and it takes a little bit longer time, 8 months. And in case of Bengal gram, this is Bengal gram, you can see yellowing and drying of the lower leaves followed by the entire death of the entire plant. This is the in vitro studies where you can observe the infection of this Ganoderma culture, white culture in the seed. And then from the seed, you can observe the pure culture of this Ganoderma from this infected Bengal gram plants. If you saw these Bengal gram or red gram plants surrounding the coconut basin, if the soil is infected, you can detect the disease earlier when compared to the other methods. And through these studies, we conducted the grouping of the pathogenic virulence of these 32 Ganoderma isolates. And you can see this is the control. This is free of without culture. And in case of inoculated plants, you observe nothing. And all the plants were dead. And in some cases, some plants are okay. Based on this, we classified the Ganoderma isolates into highly virulent, moderately virulent, and less virulent. And these are the 32 isolates that we classified based on this pathogenic virulence in Bengal gram plant. The isolates that showed more than 90% of seedling death within 30 days, they are classified as highly virulent. And these are the most of the isolates from Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, they are highly virulent. And moderately virulent, the isolates showing more than 50% of seedling death within 30 days of inoculation, these are the four isolates. And less virulent, isolates showing less than 50% of seedling death within 30 days of inoculation. This is one method to group pathogenic virulence of the isolates. And we studied isozyme analysis of also, we studied using esterase, catalase, peroxidase, and malate dehydrogenases enzymes. Among these enzymes, esterase profile, it produced 3 to 7 bands, and peroxidase 1 to 3 bands. And majority of the isolates showed 8 bands in catalase. These three enzymes we could not use, but the malate dehydrogenase profile, it grouped majority of the isolates into two categories. 3 bands, 5 bands, this is the majority of the isolates except 4. We can group it as 2 groups. And we also studied RAPD PCR using RAPD primers, 10 primers, and which produced total number of 13 to 19 bands, and all are polymorphic bands, 100% polymorphism was observed. And number of scorable bands produced per primer ranged from 13 to 19, and band size is 200 base pair to 3 KB. These are some of the photographs. And based on this RAPD analysis, we could group them as 2 clusters, group 1 and group 2. These are the 2 major clusters, and again they are classified into subsets, group 1A, group 1-2. And the maximum genetic similarity value we observed is 88%. And based on all the pathogenic virulence, isozyme and RAPD PCR, these are the grouping we observed from 32 Ganoderma isolates. Most of all Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, and then Tamil Nadu isolates we grouped. And for comparison, we obtained DMR isolates from Himachal Pradesh, Solan, for grouping. And from this grouping, we observed that most of the Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka isolates are very virulent when compared to the Tamil Nadu isolates. And coming to other factor, identification of resistance to BCR. Till now, around 44 coconut varieties are hybrids that were screened against basal stem rot disease under ASCRP and PALM scheme at HRS Ambachipeta, but none of the germplasm showed resistance to the pathogen. All the developed hybrids and available varieties from CPCRI Kasargod, they were brought and studied for the identification of resistance, including our Gangapandam, East Coast All, West Coast All, and then Godavari Ganga, and then Abhay Ganga, Vainthai Ganga also we studied, but none of the germplasm till now they showed resistance to the basal stem rot or Ganoderma wilt. And there are vast studies on biological control of Ganoderma, including plant extracts, antagonistic microorganisms, and then chemical control, biological control, everything. But we are fortunate that biological control is very effective in case of coconut against this Ganoderma. And these are the photographs of Ganoderma aplanatum and Ganoderma lucidum against Trichoderma viridi, Trichoderma hadzianum, and Trichoderma hamatum. You can see the mycoparasitism of this Trichoderma on Ganoderma. an effective biocontrolism should be efficient in competition, and then anti-mycoparasitism or antibiasis. If it has three or more characters, it shows highly efficient biocontrol agent. These are the scanning electron microscope pictures. And this is a program at ACRP Palms, HRS Ambajapeta, where soil application of different combinations of Trichoderma viridi and Pseudomonas fluorescens along with neem cake, they were studied. And our Andhra Pradesh situation, East Godavari and West Godavari, because of Godavari belt, because of high rainfall area, because of relative humidity, we are very fortunate, like we are lucky, because this biological control system is very effective in case of our area, whereas the same program, it is also being conducted at Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, but they couldn't find this much effectiveness of Trichoderma against basal stem rot, Ganoderma. In our case, 50 gram of Trichoderma viridi along with 1 kg or 5 kg of neem cake is sufficient. But they couldn't get the result, so they increased the concentration to 1.25 gram of Trichoderma, 250 gram, 500 gram, like that. But in our conditions, 50 to 100 gram of Trichoderma viridi along with 5 kg of neem cake is highly effective. And this table, the rhizosphere management, I could show you, because with biological control, with Trichoderma, the symptoms, like how we can see the disease is getting reduced. Here you can see, we applied September 12, by the September 13, by Jan 14 only, we could see the drying of the reddish hue symptom. It may take around 9 months to 1 year before showing that our biological control is effective. So we have to rely, we have to see, we have to apply multiple times, but the biological control, they effectively controls the basal stem rot. This table, because I wanted to show you, it takes time. Because this is a complex disease. From root system, after applying your Trichoderma, it has to take care of the infected root system and then stem, and then it has to come up the basal stem portion. By that time only, it has to reduce the oozing symptom on the stem. So because of this complexity, it may take time, but still it is effective. This is the drying symptom, drying of the basal stem rot symptom on the treated plant at Gannavaram village after treatment application. So from these studies, the final management studies of IDM, integrated disease management package for Ganoderma, because of the absence of resistant germplasm, we have to depend on these factors only. First point is drip irrigation or basin method of irrigation you have to follow, because the soil-borne pathogen, it moves from one plant to the other plant through irrigation water, or through whenever the floods are there, it may move from one plant to another plant through root-to-root contact. It may move, and whenever the sporophores or brackets are produced on the plant, it then becomes to the aerial spread. So you have to follow drip or basin method of irrigation to avoid the movement of the pathogen from the infected plant to the surrounding healthy plant. And then frequent watering or irrigation, especially during summer months, because in these months, in particularly in sandy soils, because of the plant will be in disadvantaged stage and the pathogen may overtake. Because of that time, because of that problem, the farmers has to take at least one or two irrigations during summer months, and then avoid injury or damage to the roots, because by injury you are making you are paving a way for the Ganoderma to easily enter the plant. And then raising or plowing in situ green manure crops, because the disease is very easily absorbed. The pathogen is very severe in sandy soils. To improve the organic content in the sandy soils, you have to go for raising and plowing of in situ green manure crops. By addition of organic matter, you provide some nutrients to the plant, and then to fight against Ganoderma pathogen. And then uprooting and destruction of diseased or dead palms along with the roots. This is the most important point. Generally, farmers won't do, even though we suggest so many times. But we have to compulsorily go for uprooting and destruction of diseased plant. By this method, physically we remove the inoculum load, of Ganoderma in the soil. To the, at least to 30 to 40% reduction will be there. After that, you go for biological control or chemical control, then it will be effective. And then isolation of diseased palms from healthy palms by digging isolation trenches of 1 meter depth or 0.5 meter width. This is physically isolating the diseased palms so that the spread to the healthy plants will not be there. And then raising of indicator plants for early detection. Whatever the red gram or Bengal gram plants, we can sow, and then otherwise molecular methods the farmers may not get. But indicator plants, they can go for indicator plants and then see whether there is infection in their field. If there is no infection, don't bring the infected, don't bring the coconut seedlings from the infected nurseries. And then finally, coming to the biological control, application of 50 gram of Trichoderma in combination with 5 kg of neem cake to the diseased palms once in a year. This is the, even though it may take some time, this is very effective. And the same mixture, if in an acre, if one or two plants are infected, you have to go for the application of the above said mixture at the rate of 1 kg to all the healthy plants in the field. Because we don't know by that time the disease or pathogen, it was spread to the other healthy palms. So we have to go for application of the same said mixture to the all the plants. And then finally, the root feeding of chemical fungicides, hexaconazole and tridimorph. It is tridimorph is not available now. Hexaconazole 1% root feeding, you can go. But when compared to IDM practice, you have to follow. And this biological control is highly effective in case of basal stem rot. And this is how you apply Trichoderma along with neem cake. You have to remove all the weeds in the surrounding the trunk. You have to apply entire area and then irrigate. After application of Trichoderma, you have to make the plant irrigated and maintain the water level like wet conditions for 3 to 4 days in order to establish the Trichoderma in the coconut basin. This technology under Coconut Development Board, two projects we carried out. One is mass multiplication and demonstration of biocontrol based integrated disease management package against basal stem rot disease in coconut. This large scale demonstration of this developed package along with the prophylactic and curative package, we demonstrated in coconut farmer's garden, 5 acres, 5 acres at Antarvedi and Kesanpalli we took. And this is the number of diseased palms we observed in 5 acres field of Antarvedi is in August 2012 is 244. By August 2013, by 1 year, you could observe the reduction of infected plants to 102. And percent disease instances in August 2012 is 38.85 to 14.64. So as in Kesanpalli also, 112 plants in August 2012, they got reduced to 70 plants by August 2013. And this is the drying up of the symptom at the base of the trunk. These are all the infected plants before August 2012. By August 2013, you could observe the drying of the symptom. If the disease is initial stage, you can see complete removal of the pathogen and recovery of the plant. This is another project where 50 acre garden gardens at 5 locations, Kalvacherla, Pedapudi, Gannavaram of East Godavari district and Jagathi and Borivanka villages of Srikakulam districts. These 5 villages we have selected and 50 acre coconut gardens we have selected, and the same biocontrol agents we have applied, and this is the result. In all the 5 villages, there is reduction in number of diseased plants by August 2013, and in all the cases, there is reduction except Kalvacherla, because it is highly infected garden. By the time we applied, majority of the palms are severely infected. Here we couldn't observe, but all the remaining 4 villages, we could observe reduction in the disease symptom. This is percent recovery of the plants from Kalocharla, Jagathi, Borivanka and Pedapudi. And these are the drying up of the symptom on the plant. But here in biological control, we have to apply the trichoderma viridi along with neem cake at periodical intervals, better at 6 months interval. And you have to observe for the symptoms on the trunk, and early detection and early apply of the biological control will be very useful. And because the response of the palms to the treatment depends on stage of the disease development. If it is in early stage, you can completely recover the plants. Along with, you have to follow good agronomic practices, soil characteristics such as, and then management also depends on effectiveness of trichoderma viridi isolate. The isolate that is available at HRS Ambachipeta is highly effective against Ganoderma of coconut. All the farmers, they do realize there is high demand. Only because of registration, it was lagging, but it is very effective isolate. And biological control approach, we can say the trichoderma isolate from Ambachipeta, it is like role model. Like another one, this is basal stem rot, Ganoderma. Next, coming to the stem bleeding, this is Tilaviopsis paradoxa. This disease also, it was first reported in Sri Lanka and in India. And disease occurs in all the soils, but more in sandy and laterite soils. The stem bleeding etiology is Tilaviopsis paradoxa. And then you can see the symptoms like oozing of the black liquid, reddish brown to black liquid on the trunk of the palm. And this is local infection. It won't infect the roots first and later enter into the stem. It is local infection. Whenever there is a wound on the trunk of the palm, you can observe the oozing of the liquid at that particular wound place. Here you can see streaks of the oozing on the basal trunk at multiple locations. Later, there are the tissue will disintegrate and you can see cracks on the stem. Because of this tissue, because of these cracks, whenever there are cyclones, this plant particularly may be susceptible to topple down. And these are the surveys we conducted in Vijayanagaram district, sandy soil and sole coconut as well as coconut with intercrops. And this is how to differentiate Ganoderma wilt, stem bleeding and red palm weevil. In all the three cases, you can observe oozing of the reddish brown liquid on the trunk portion. But in case of Ganoderma wilt, the exudation moves upward from the basal trunk region. And in case of stem bleeding, oozing at one point or multiple points and oozing of the liquid, the infection is at one point and the liquid moves downward. And in case of red palm weevil, you can observe entry hole at the ooze point. In case of Ganoderma, it is mostly in sandy soils and stem bleeding also, even though in all the soils, sandy soils, it is very prevalent. And whereas in case of red palm weevil, it is in black soil. And the basal stem rot, it majorly on mature palms. Whereas in stem bleeding also on mature palms, but red palm weevil, the palms aged below 5 to 10 years are susceptible to red palm weevil. And in case of Ganoderma, you can see death of the plant. In case of red palm weevil, you can observe death of the plant. And in case of stem bleeding, very rarely palm dies. These are the differentiating points of all the three. If you go to the field, you have to observe for multiple plants and then only observe, confirm whether it is basal stem rot or stem bleeding, or if the plantation is younger one and there is entry hole at the oozing point, you can go for insect red palm weevil presence. And management is, because it is local pathogen, weak pathogen, only local entry will be there. So avoid damage to the palms. and apply trichoderma viridi paste and diseased portion of the plant, and then same apply 50 gram of trichoderma viridi and 5 kg of neem cake, because the pathogen is soil borne. This will take care of the inoculum load in soil. This is SEM pictures of trichoderma against Tilaviopsis paradoxa, and this is field evaluation. Maybe Neeraja will cover more, because where trichoderma virens cake, how it is effective against stem bleeding. And another one is bud rot caused by Phytophthora palmivora. This is also a major problem in Andhra Pradesh, in both in nursery as well as mature plants. But bud rot is more severe in nursery plants. The first visible symptom is withering and yellowing of the spindle leaf. I'll go a little bit fast. This is the yellowing and withering of the spindle leaf, followed by withering and yellowing of the surrounding leaves. If you pull out the center leaf, it comes out easily, and you can observe rotting of the tissue in the pull out leaf. It comes out easily, and rotting you can observe, dirty odor you can smell from this infected portion. And then on the nut also you can observe water soluble lesions, which later turn into the brown or black lesions. You can observe growth of the white mycelium on this nut. Because the nut is infected with the disease, it easily drops down from the plant. It absorbs moisture from the atmosphere surrounding air, and because of the weight, the nut drops down from the plant. And you can see only the live plant without production of new leaves. Without production of new leaves means without production of nuts. In case of bud rot, center leaf will be infected first, surrounded by the surrounded leaves. But in case of basal stem rot, the disease is observed first on the lower set of the leaves, then middle leaves, and then top leaf. These are the two contrasting features of basal stem rot and bud rot. Management is, the disease is severe in case of black soils, where generally farmers go for, we recommend 60 palms per plant, 18 to 8 meter or 7.5 into 7.5 meter for hybrid. We recommend that spacing for coconut, but farmers go for more number of plants. And if they go for more number of plants, whenever there is black cottony soils are there, whenever there are rains and there is no drainage facility, then this bud rot infestation, there are chances of bud rot infestation. So if that is black cotton area, and then if there are no proper drainage facilities, go for recommended spacing. Provide better drainage facilities, because Phytophthora it favors high relative humidity and high rainfall. And then removal of the infected or dead plants and application. Here we can say Pseudomonas fluorescens is the biological effective biological control agent against this bud rot. And in extreme, like this chemical management is spraying of drenching, pouring of the copper oxychloride 3 gram per liter of water at the infected portion. And if the infection does not reach the germinating point, you can revive the plant. But if once the infection goes to the germinating point, there are no chances for revival of the palm. And these are the minor diseases: gray leaf blight caused by Pestalozoospis palmarum. Here you can see yellow spots. Center is dark brown color, and then this is only in neglected gardens. When there are heavy rainfalls and farmers are unable to take proper cultural practices, then if the field is neglected, you can observe this gray leaf spot caused by Pestalozoospis palmarum. This is the spores of Pestalozoospis. And only thing is, remove the cut and remove the infected leaves. Only the lower leaves will be infected. So those leaves you remove and apply either copper oxychloride or bordomixer. Anything will be sufficient. And once this is reported during 90s or 80s, Tatipaka caused by Phytoplasma. Tatipaka is one of the place at Jagannapeta in East Godavari district. At that place, it was first observed. So it is called as Tatipaka. And Our DE Srinivas sir, he took electron microscopy image of this phytoplasma from Tatpaka infected plant. Later, they took a campaign removing all the Tatpaka infected palms, either viral or phytoplasmal. Once you go for removal of the infected plant, they removed and now the disease was not there. But the same phytoplasmal root wilt, it is high major disease in Kerala, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. Because at that time, our seniors, they realized the importance of this program, they removed. Now we don't have any Tatpaka or root wilt phytoplasmal diseases of in coconut in Andhra Pradesh. This is leaf blight, Lacerodiploidea theobromae casual organism. In other states, it is a very severe program, such as Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. But in our Andhra, recently, Neerja, she detected appearance of Lacerodiploidea theobromae. These are the symptoms, affected palm. This is also observed in mature plants and affected leaflets. You can see infection from leaflet tip that moves downward to the midrib. Drying of the entire leaflets and then necrotic areas and petiole, and in buttons also you can observe the infection. This is the culture and the Lacerodiploidea spores, immature conidia and mature conidia. And management spores are the spores, they spread the disease, and management is remove and burnt of the severely infected leaves and application of border mixer 1% or copper oxychloride 0.3%. This is leaf rot, another Xerohilum. Once we observed in Thuni area, where rotting of the browning and yellowing and browning of the middle leaves, not the lower also, sometimes middle leaves, and rotting at the base of the leaves, leaf base, it's observed. And then rotting, these symptoms we observed in Thuni and Vishakhapatnam area, Pycropeta. Only there we could observe, later it did not appear. This is caused by Xerohilum species. And coming to the last disease, this is root wilt phytoplasma. Even though in our state it is not there, it is major problem in Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka and Goa. These are the symptoms: abnormal inward bending of the leaflets, termed as ribbing or flaccidity. Ribbing or flaccidity, this is the major characteristic symptom. And then yellowing and marginal necrosis of the leaflets. These are the major symptoms. And here, palms of all age group are affected. And if pre-bearing plants are infected, they don't come for flowering. And here also you can observe rotting of the roots. Because of the infection, you can see shedding of immature nuts and drying up of the spathes and necrosis of spikelets. In unopened inflorescences also you can observe. And husk, kernel and oil of the diseased plants are of poor quality in case of root wilt affected plants. Casual organism is phloem limited phytoplasma, and spread is by insect vectors, lace bug, Staphylococcus typica and plant hopper, Protist tematosa, temesta, and then tolerant varieties of CPCRI. They released three tolerant varieties, Kalparaksha, Kalpastri and Kalpasankara. They say these are the three tolerant varieties, and management is through phytosanitation, rejuvenation and selection of disease-free mother palms, and biopriming of seedlings with bioinoculants such as Pseudomonas fluorescens, and application of organic manures and green manuring. This is the management practice for root wilt. Thank you.
Padma, participants, all the session is open for questions. If you have any doubts, you can ask Dr. Snehalatha madam. So you can post either in the chat box or you can ask directly by unmuting yourself if you are in Zoom.
Thank you.
Ravi, any questions posted in YouTube chat box?
I think
Ravi Kiran.
Ravi, Indra.
No, no, ma'am. No questions in the YouTube, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, then.
You can close the session. RV Sujata, you can close.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Snehala Tarani, madam, for enlightening the participants with your elaborate lecture on different types of diseases in coconut and management strategies to be followed for control of those diseases, with a special emphasis on Ganoderma wilt. Thank you, Dr. Snehala Tarani. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sujata.
Thank you. Thank you, Sneha.
Thanks, Padma.
Thank you.